without further ado, we will go ahead and get started. And we'll start out with a real short introduction from Casey Henry, who is one of our AmeriCorps Vistas doing food justice work in Cincinnati.
All right. Thanks, everyone, for being here. We've all heard the term GMO, and whether we like it or not, we've all eaten them at some point. GMO stands for genetically modified organism, which are plants or animals created through the gene splicing techniques of biotechnology. Genetic modification is achieved by combining genes from different plants, animals, or bacteria to attain an organism with a set of desired characteristics. The Presbyterian Hunger Program advocates the need to develop and protect an agricultural system that provides an adequate, safe, and locally acceptable food supply for all of the world's people, and to do so in ways that are environmentally sustainable. This webinar is intended to expose the true ways in which we are all affected by GMOs. Despite claims by big agribusiness that genetic engineering will increase food production and end world hunger, there are serious risks, health concerns, and devastating consequences for farmers that every consumer deserves to know about. At this time, I'll turn it over to Margot McMillen.
And actually, let me make a quick comment. We'll have question and answer time, which you can just do by unmuting yourself and asking a question. But we've also got the function on the webinar where you can type in a question. On the right, usually you should have a little window that you can open up and type in a question and just press enter, and we can see what kind of questions are coming up and try to get to some of those during the call. Thanks, Margot.
Okay. Well, thanks for having me. I really appreciate it. And the first slide here just kind of tells who I am in Mid-Missouri. I've been working on rural issues for a couple of decades, and it's really hard for farmers to get the message out. So as you can see, you know, you just try everything. You do community radio, you do any columns you can get a hold of, anything else. So that's sort of where we've been, and I really appreciate getting to talk to a little wider audience today.
Margot, if you can just be a little closer to your speaker. People are having a little trouble hearing.
Oh, okay. Is this better?
I think so. Yeah. Thanks.
Okay. Well, having said that, the question is, why should urban people really learn about farming? And the answer is that farming really takes a lot of the land. In fact, in Missouri here, it's 3/4 of the land. Sometimes I think if you're, you know, in an urban environment, you don't think about how much there is outside of you. But anyway, that's how it is. So then on the next slide, I just thought I'd just mention a little bit about our farm, which is Terra Farm in Hatton, Missouri. And we're surrounded on all sides for miles and miles around by farmers who raise GMO corn and soybeans. But on our farm, the mission is food for the local community, and then we also like the arts, so we have art for all and health for the rural ecosystem, including the farmers. So even though our neighbors are raising GMOs, we care about them, and we see that the situation for them is not good. They're on a treadmill of working really, really hard and being in a lot of debt and having very little to show at the end of the year. In our community, probably like a lot of urban communities, the majority of kids in the county are getting food assistance at school. So we try to have people onto the farm and talk to them about how they can raise their own food and how they can really get better food. We're, you know, you hear about food deserts in the urban places, but rural places are really food deserts. And the town closest to us, the only place where you could really buy food is gas stations. There aren't any grocery stores or other places. And then, on the next slide, we're also really involved with the food sovereignty movement, and we think that that's a really big fight against GMOs taking over the food system. And just to sort of give an idea of what the food sovereignty movement is, This is a quote from the Declaration of NYLENA, which says, just in part, food sovereignty is the right of peoples to healthy and culturally appropriate food produced through ecologically sound and sustainable methods, and their right to define their own food and agriculture systems. It puts those who produce, distribute, and consume food at the heart of the food system and food policies rather than the demands of the markets and corporations. And it defends the interests and inclusion of the next generation. And I thought I'd just mention a few definitions just so, you know, we can all be on the same page. So that's the next slide. Industrial, commodity, monoculture, or row crop farm are these big farms that have rows of one single crop raised over a lot of acres. And here in Missouri, 90% of row crop soybean and corn farms use genetically altered seeds. And I think that's probably true in most places where that kind of agriculture is going on. Just to talk about what genetically altered is, because I find a lot of confusion on these issues. If a seed is genetically altered, it's actually had a gene from some other species inserted into the seed, like a bacteria cell inserted into corn to kill rootworms. And once that's done, the new gene is replicated in all of the cells, and they also, genetically altered technology is also called GE, biotech, transgenic, God move over, GMO. It seems like every time the world figures out what, you know, what GE means or GMO means, then the scientists change the name of it. So there's a lot of little synonyms. A hybrid is when two or more parent plants of the same species are crossed, like a short and a tall wheat plant, to make a variety with qualities of both. And that kind of hybridization goes back to like the 1920s. An heirloom is an old variety, and it's usually created by indigenous people who want to save the best from their ecosystem. A lot of times they will take those with them, and that's how most of the heirlooms came to this country, is they came from Europe. And a native is just a variety that's developed by nature, and it's mostly just in your ecological niche. So, you know, you might have the question of why farmers have adopted GMOs. And back in the 90s, when these were introduced, there was a lot of concern about erosion. And so farmers were feeling pretty, criticized because of the huge amount of erosion that was going on. So erosion is caused quite often by plowing, and the idea was that if you could kill the weeds with chemicals, you didn't have to plow as much. So that was one of the positives that was given to farmers. Industry and universities and commodity groups have really convinced farmers that GMOs are the easiest way to go. And I started going to these meetings back in 96. I was at the first meeting where GMOs were introduced in our county, and any criticism was completely stifled. It was quite surprising to me. And then, of course, you know, as seeds have become patented, the old sources have disappeared. So saving your patented seeds is illegal. In order to replant seeds, there has to be a company or a tradition called a seed cleaner, where they run the seeds through a machine that blows off any chaff or wheat and weeds, that kind of thing, so that when they replant, they have clean seeds to replant. And as one of my neighbors who was a seed cleaner told me, the year after GMOs appeared, his business went to zero, so he isn't cleaning seeds at all anymore. But on the next slide, farmers are catching on. And as we all know, there's been dozens of weeds that are resistant to glyphosate. What industry says then is that we should use more chemicals, and the chemicals that are used are generally more poisonous and really more dangerous. But some of the good news is about 2 weeks ago, there was an organic field day at the University of Missouri, the first one ever, and the newspaper said there were 300 people and 75% were row croppers. So that was very exciting to those of us who are interested in this. And then we also have a new generation of people coming on. And in my neighborhood, I'm pleased to say that the younger farmers are trying out new systems like rotational grazing. But we still have a lot of debt, and the industrial ag is always emphasizing profit. That's all you hear from industrial ag is how much money you can make. You don't really hear anything about quality of life or health or any of those kinds of things. So I won't really go into this slide too much because it's kind of long, but you can see that there's a lot of hype that's going into industrial ag and goes into the farmers' magazines and media that we get. And then, you know, the next slide, industrial ag pays off for consumers, too, because food is a lot cheaper. And we're eating a whole lot more. And I think it's almost shocking that in 2002 we each ate 12% more pounds of food than we did in 1970. And it's interesting to me when I look at pictures of when my kids were growing up in the 70s, how much skinnier the kids were and how much skinnier the grown-ups were, too. So I kind of wanted to conclude with just a little bit of a description of what happened on our farm this summer, because for the first time we had an herbicide kill, which was drifted from a neighbor's farm. So as I said at the beginning, we are surrounded by row croppers, but we grow food. So this slide shows a picture of one of our grapevines that kind of right dead center, there's a curled up leaf that you can see, and that's one of the signs of poisoning, and the grape board told me that they thought it was 2,4-D, which probably makes sense because this would be the first time that it would be sprayed would be this year. So we don't know how those vines are going to survive. In the next slide, it shows the slides on the grapes on the left that actually caught the spray, and as one friend told us, it was like a wind barrier for the other bunch of grapes. And it's very dramatic. I don't know if you can tell, if you don't look at grapes very often, you might not realize that. But if you get close to them, we won't be harvesting any grapes off the vines on the left. They're pretty shot for this year, and we hope they'll come back. We just don't know yet. So just to sort of give one more definition, sometimes people don't know what sustainability is, and there is an actual definition. It came from a UN Commission on the Environment and Development, and it just basically says that sustainable development is development that meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of the future. And that's certainly what we all want. And I just, as my last slide, I just wanted to mention that in our state, and I'm sure in other states, there is an effort from corporations to actually buy the land. So when I started out by saying that 2/3 of the land is owned by farmers, that means that it's in private hands at this point. Corporations can only own a little bit of land in Missouri through a really weird piece of history. So, but there was actually a bill passed this last year that would allow corporate ownership of land, and that has been vetoed by the governor. I'm not sure if we have a fight on our hands because the General Assembly has what they call a bulletproof majority, so they could override his veto. Most of the people I talk to think they will not try to, so I don't know. That's still open. But just the fact that it passed, I think, is appalling, and people should think about that. So, okay, thank you all for having me on, and I'll just turn it back to Andrew. Or Kate. Anyway, I'll turn it back to you.
Okay.
Thanks.
Thanks so much, Margot. And, yeah, why don't we take any questions that came up for folks? If you came on since we started, If you're not asking a question, make sure you're on mute. You've muted your phone or pressed star 6. But if you would like to ask a question, you can unmute by doing star 6 and ask a question. And it can be super simple to from, like, what's a row crop farmer, or anything that you heard that you would love to hear clarification or expansion on. Anybody? Okay, well, why don't I take just 2 minutes before we go to Katherine Zavala to just mention, almost give the highlights or the headlines of some concerns about GMOs. The health issues are certainly one of them that's still an unanswered question, or what are the long-term effects of eating GMOs? What they've found from various animal studies is that there are, in fact, some serious effects of eating GM feed, and they include organ damage, gastrointestinal and immune system disorders, accelerated aging, and infertility. The way GMOs, you've probably heard about the impact of contamination as pollen drifts from GM crops to non-GM crops. The thing is about cross-pollinating and this kind of genetic contamination is that once it happens, you can't go back. Contamination is forever, basically. GMOs have, since the GM crops have been introduced, the amount of herbicides has actually increased. And a lot of that has to do with the type of crops that Monsanto and others have introduced, which are herbicide tolerant, Roundup ready. So despite the claims that GM crops are better for the environment, the fact is that herbicide use is increasing and will likely continue to as super weeds develop resistance to the Roundup. There are other dangerous side effects to genetic engineering, potentially as you mix unrelated species that are still unpredictable, and some cases of that have happened where they've been quite damaging. At one, the people may remember the monarch butterfly impact a while back. One of the other big problems is that government oversight over GMOs is dangerously lax. The science is often unclear, partly because of all the research that is funded by the biotech industry itself. And in some cases, suppression of any other independent research that comes out. Finally, a couple other points would be that GMOs do, in fact, harm the environment. Roundup has been proven to be much more damaging than first thought. And we're seeing wild strain or GM strains of canola growing in places as far reaching as North Dakota and California, and threatening to pass on its herbicide tolerant genes to the weeds. And finally, GMOs, despite the claims, have not increased yields. And through the contamination, through the grabbing of market share, actually work against feeding a hungry world where almost a billion people live with chronic hunger. So, one more chance. Any other questions or comments before our next speaker?
Can you hear me? Yeah. Hi, Andrew. This is Whitney in Indianapolis. I have a question for Margaret, regarding the cross-contamination with the grape plant. Are there any legal actions that are currently set in place that you can, like, sue for losses, or is it pretty much a lost cause when things like that happen?
Well, it's actually getting some attention, which is pretty gratifying right now. I've been able to connect with a few other farmers who have had similar experiences, and in our case, it's a fairly small loss. It's 1 year's, you know, harvest out of, I guess, about 10 plants. But some people have actually lost even more. So there's beginning to be some awareness. The Department of Ag has actually started taking a little bit of, you know, making a little bit of attention. It's ironic because grapes and timber are two of the most delicate of plants when it comes to 2,4-D, and both of them the state has put a ton of money into. You know, we have a lot of people in the wine industry now and a lot of people raising timber now. So I think this year I could probably collect from the farmer who did it because he would have insurance, and I've talked to other people who have actually collected in, from their insurance companies. So that's a possibility. At this point, I just want him to not do it anymore, so I'm trying to just see, you know, just talk to him about it and make sure that he uses a little bit different strategy when he sprays. But, you know, I think it's starting to get attention, which is very hopeful.
We had a question that came online from Michael Taylor. His question to either of the speakers is, who is controlling and redirecting the studies? Do you have a comment on that, Margot?
The first question was, is there an effort to thwart the studies that would show any problems with GMOs, their growth, any ineffective growth comparisons with traditional crops or heirloom crops, as well as the effects on humans and animals that are consuming those crops, and then who's doing that thwarting of those studies?
Well, it's an interesting question because, as we've said, these are patented seeds. So in order to do a study, a scientist has to get permission from the patent holder. So if, you know, for example, you know, it's, Monsanto's not the only company making these. There's also Syngenta, and there's probably some others that I think of right now. But in order, if you wanted to run a study, let's say, on yield or on the health effects on using it as animal feed or whatever, you know, whatever study you wanted to do, you would have to get the permission of those companies in order to use the seed in that way. And this has been a real challenge and almost impossible to meet here in the United States. Some European companies have, it seems to me they're just kind of saying, we're going to do it, and, you know, if there's a challenge, we'll take that when we get it. But at this point in the United States, scientists who are mostly at universities, research universities, aren't able to actually get permission to run the kinds of tests that they would, you know, be interested in running.
Great. Well, we will have time for some more questions after Katherine presents about the impact of GMOs more globally. Katherine works with the International Development Exchange, IDEX, out in San Francisco, that works around the world in various countries. IDEX is also a member of the U.S. Food Sovereignty Alliance, and we're honored to have her join us.
Thank you, Adrian. I will just
switch over to her so we can see her screen.
All right. Hello, everyone. Thank you so much, Andrew, for this invitation, and thank you, Margot, for that wonderful introduction and presentation on what's going on in Missouri. I'm going to talk a little bit more about the global framework around GMOs, and I will just touch upon a little bit about IDEX. IDEX identifies, evaluates, and grows the best ideas to alleviate poverty and injustice around the world. We connect passionate and engaged supporters to visionary local leaders and organizations. Currently, we work in 6 countries, in Mexico, Guatemala, India, Nepal, South Africa, and Zimbabwe. And all of our grassroots partners are working on food justice in various ways. So all the learnings I am going to share with you come from our Global South partners. So here's a brief outline of what I'm going to talk about, but I'm just going to go and dive deep right now. I'm going to start with what's happening currently today in terms of the status of the world hunger. Today, as Andrew mentioned before, there are about 1 billion hungry people in the planet, but hunger is caused by poverty and inequality, not scarcity due to lack of production. The world already produces enough food to feed 9 to 10 billion people, which is actually the population peak expected by 2050, because today there's 7 billion people in the world. The bulk of industrially produced grain crops go to biofuels and confined animals. We need an alternative agriculture developmental paradigm, one that encourages more ecologically biodiverse, resilient, sustainable, and socially just forms of agriculture. The basis for such new systems of food sovereignty are the myriad of ecologically based agricultural styles developed by at least 75% of the 1.5 billion smallholders, family farmers, and indigenous people today on 350 million small farms. Most of the food consumed today in the world is derived from 5,000 domestic crop species and 1.9 million peasant-bred plant varieties, mostly grown without agrochemicals. However, the solutions for smallholder agriculture advocated by big bilateral donors, governments, and the initiatives of private foundations have tended to center around the promotion of synthetic fertilizers and pesticides, which are costly for farmers and often resource depleting. This drive for a new green revolution, as exemplified by the Alliance for a Green Revolution Africa, AGRA, as it's mostly known, has tended to sideline more sustainable farmer-led approaches. So for those who know of the original Green Revolution, it provided a promise to end hunger through miracle seeds. These miracle seeds would supposedly increase grain yield. Although improving seeds through experimentation is what people have been up to since the beginning of agriculture, the term Green Revolution was coined in the 1960s to highlight a particularly striking breakthrough. This started in test plots in northwest Mexico, where improved varieties of wheat dramatically increased yields. Much of the reason why these modern varieties produced more than traditional varieties was that they were more responsive to controlled irrigation and to petrochemical fertilizers, allowing for much more efficient conversion of industrial inputs into food. So with a big boost from the International Agriculture Research Centers created by the Rockefeller and the Ford Foundations, these miracle seeds quickly spread to Asia, and soon new strains of rice and corn were developed as well. By the 1990s, almost 75% of Asian rice areas were sown with these new varieties. The same was true for almost half of the wheat planted in Africa and more than half of that in Latin America and Asia. Overall, it was estimated that 40% of all farmers in the Global South were using Green Revolution seeds, with the greatest use found in Asia, followed by Latin America. Did this prove itself to be a successful strategy? Not really. The Green Revolution narrowly focused on increased production, and it also altered the tightly concentrated distribution of especially access to land and purchasing power. Basically, if the poor didn't have the money to buy food, increased production wasn't going to help them. With the Green Revolution, farming became petrol-dependent, and as mentioned before, the increased use of fertilizer. And in India alone, adoption of the new seeds had been accompanied by a 6-fold rise in fertilizer use per acre. Flash forward to 1999. Where AGRA, the Alliance for Green Revolution in Africa, it became an initiative launched by the Rockefeller Foundation, joined 7 years later by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. Public-private partnerships became a cornerstone of AGRA. Private investment is seen as necessary to stimulate economic growth, and so Africa represented a huge potential for new markets for agribusinesses. For example, at the 2006 Africa Fertilizer Summit, funded by the Rockefeller Foundation, more than 40 African governments agreed to lift all cross-border taxes and tariffs on chemical fertilizers. AGRA promotes a failed technology. It simply is the flagship project for a larger industrial campaign for a green revolution based on the spread of genetically engineered crops. While AGRA is not directly distributing genetically engineered seeds in Africa, It is training the scientists and setting up of the infrastructure for the spread of these genetically modified crops. And by building partnerships with state governments, promoting genetically modified seeds to be part of government schemes to farmers. Biotechnology has had dismal results in Africa in recent years. For example, field trials in Kenya showed Monsanto's multi-million dollar virus-resistant sweet potato variety to be no less virus-resistant and no more productive than local varieties. In another example of spectacular failure, three varieties of Monsanto's GM maize failed to produce crops during the 2008-2009 growing season in South Africa, leaving as many as 200,000 hectares of cornfields barren, as well as crop losses across rural provinces. Monsanto compensated commercial farmers who lost their yield and barred them from speaking out publicly. I'm going to touch upon two countries to talk a little bit more about GMOs. One is South Africa. South Africa is one of the seven developing countries worldwide which are growing GM crops for commercial purposes, and I believe it's the only country on the African continent producing a genetically modified crop that is part of the staple food of its population, which is white maize. South Africa imports and exports GM maize as animal feed. Now, South Africa devotes an estimated 300,000 hectares to growing GM white and yellow maize, soybean, and cotton. Field trials have been conducted on potatoes, wheat, canola, sugarcane, apple, eucalyptus, strawberry, sugar beet, tomato, and sweet potato to identify GM varieties for commercial production. If you look on the slide, the photo on the right, those are genetically modified eucalyptus trees in the far end of the photo. The South African agriculture mirrors the high levels of inequality in the country. There is large-scale industrialized commercial farming sector on one side, and on the other, a small-scale, labor-intensive, low-input sector where farming is often one of a number of livelihood strategies for poor rural households. Commercial agriculture produces most of the food for the country and makes an important contribution to export earnings. The small-scale agriculture is largely confined to the former apartheid homelands. These areas remain home to a third of South Africa's population and 70% of the poor. In South Africa, the uptake of GM crops among small-scale farmers has been limited to schemes, government packages, where farmers receive a package of inputs and support and loans from the land bank. And with these government schemes, the farmer risks getting trapped in debt cycles if their crops fail and they're not able to repay loans and buy seeds again. Also, South Africa doesn't have a well-developed policy on GMOs, nor do they include the public in decision-making about GM activities in the country. They do have a GMO Act of 15 of 1997, which is supposed to regulate the production and releases of GMOs in the country and should address biosafety concerns, but it contains a number of flaws. It does not make adequate provisions for risk assessments. It imposes liability for environmental and other damage on the end user, that means the farmer or consumer, rather than the provider, and it does not allow for proper public input or oversight in permit granting procedures. The Act is essentially a mechanism to fast-track permits for field trials, commercial releases, and the import and export of GM crops. And there has been no public policy process to determine the use of GMOs in South Africa.
And could the speaker speak more loudly?
Sure. And decision-making has been characterized by a lack of transparency and denial of access to information, as it was witnessed in this high court case between BioWatch South Africa, a nonprofit food justice organization, and Monsanto and the Department of Agriculture. And I can share more details about that case in further on. Now I'm going to just go and talk a little bit about what's going on in Mexico. On January 31st of this year, more than 60,000 farmers and supporters from workers and environmental organizations marched through Mexico City to protest against Monsanto trying to come and bring GM corn into Mexico. With tens of thousands of people shouting, "No genetically modified corn in Mexico," and "Monsanto, get out," the march showed the muscle of an unusual grassroots movement to protect small farmers and consumers. And it also revealed the remarkable success of decades of public education and organizing on an issue that Monsanto and other major biotech firms hoped would slide under the radar of the people most affected by it. Monsanto, along with Pioneer, Dow, and other chemical biotech firms, have been pushing hard to take over production of the world's third major staple crop, which is corn. Small farmers in the U.S. have long experienced the pressure exerted to move them out of the way, And Monsanto predicts that its corn seed will be planted on 96 million acres in the U.S. this year. But the key to its plans to conquer the market lies south of the border. Monsanto, the powerful corporation, the largest seed seller in the world, desperately wants permission for unrestricted planting of its GM corn in Mexico. If GM corn is planted in Mexico, it will accelerate the transfer of acreage and water rights from small farmers to corporate GM corn cultivation, thus transferring control of the national food supply as well. Widespread open planting of GM corn will lead to contamination of native varieties. This is a scientific fact. Now, many of you know that Mexico is the center of origin of corn and the home of hundreds of varieties developed by indigenous communities over centuries. To lose in-situ preservation of these varieties is to lose a wealth of agrodiversity that has major importance for sustainable food production and to eventually become dependent on Monsanto and other large corporations to feed ourselves. So I just wanted to briefly end by just saying that there was a 2008 report by the International Assessment of Agriculture Knowledge, Science, and Technology for Development, the ICID report, which was a joint initiative of the World Bank, UNDP, the UN Food and Agriculture Organization, and others, that found the real solution to hunger was not to be found in technological fixes such as GM seeds, but rather in equitable distribution of resources and support for ecological and traditional agriculture. This agriculture contains practices which a number of our Global South partners call agroecology. And I'm also happy to explain what that means, but I thought maybe I would just end there to open it up for questions.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Katherine. That was great. And we can send around these resources when I send out a follow-up email. So we've got about 15 minutes for questions, comments, conversation. What do people have? And again, if you muted yourself and want to ask a question, press *6. And if you haven't muted yourself and aren't speaking, you can also hit *6.
Can you hear me like that?
Go ahead. Is someone speaking?
Yes. I don't know how clear this mic is, but I wanted to know if there are any private public partnerships that are doing programs that are using non-GMO methods and things like permaculture and other sustainable systems as avidly as they would be on genetically modified and things that Monsanto and the Gates Foundation have pursued.
That's a good question. I don't actually know of any cases where there is public-private partnerships around non-GM seeds. It's actually, it's only the cases I've heard where Monsanto and the other five big seed companies have been in partnership with the state government. There's a new initiative being launched that was launched at the GA Summit last year called it was something around the Alliance for Food Security and Nutrition that is investing a lot of millions and millions of dollars into this public-private partnership. But I haven't heard of any case where there is one with non-genetically modified seeds. The alliance is called the New Alliance for Food Security and Nutrition, and is backed up in the GEA Summit in May 2012.
And there was a question by Angela Boss. I don't know if you have audio and can ask that, Angela?
Yes, I'm here.
Great.
Thanks, Andrew. Just before my question, in response to the last question, I've worked with a lot of programs in Asia and Africa that are being funded through U.S. farmers who grow both traditional crops with using GM crops and organic farmers who are funding small farm programs all over the world that allow the small farmers to choose what they're using in terms of their seeds. It's not exactly it's not a public-private partnership, but it is a partnership between farmers. And in those cases, all of the programs we work with abroad are using open-pollinated seed sources that come from local communities where they choose what they're going to grow themselves. So in that sense, it's very much the grassroots programs overseas choosing what they're going to grow rather than us directing that for them from here. It doesn't make any sense. My question was for the woman from the first speaker, if she could talk a little bit more about building bridges and working together with traditional farmers who are caught in that GM crop cycle, and what she's seen or suggestions for how to build some of those bridges and how we can work together with farmers in the United States who are like her next door neighbor.
I really appreciate that, because I think that's something that's kind of been left out of the discussion, and I think we really should try to go in that direction a little bit. And one of the things I've noticed in my neighborhood is there's just in the last couple of years been three young men who have started to take over their dad's farms. And two of them have taken classes at the University of Missouri in sustainable agriculture, which has just been available in the last 6 or 8 years, thanks to some really hard work by some people who just insisted that the university put that into the curriculum. So I think that they are trying things that their dads go, oh, I don't know, this isn't going to work. And they really kind of have to fight an uphill battle slightly with their dads. But luckily, they are from families who are indulgent enough. And, you know, since farmers really haven't made much money from GMO, they're getting a little disgusted themselves and fed up with the whole patenting system. So I think this is something that really could get some traction, probably a lot of places in the Midwest. I know a lot of farmers through the National Family Farm Coalition who are, well, several of them will just say to you, I had to plant a GMO crop this year because I couldn't get non-GMO seeds. And sometimes, quite often actually, they don't even use the herbicide strategies that are part of the package when they buy a patented seed, but they just don't really feel like they have a choice. It's really, really hard to get non-GMO seeds, even if you go organic, and organic is another area that's kind of growing and people are interested in it. So I think that's a great idea to try to figure out how to build some more bridges.
Any other comments on that question from anyone else? How to build bridges.
Andrew, this is Katherine. I really appreciate Angela bringing up the alternative partnerships that are going on, which are the farmer-to-farmer learning exchanges around seeds, around agroecology, around how to build sustainable food production that is contextually based in your community. These are the examples we see a lot in the Global South as a way to be resilient and to provide that alternative model to the public-private partnerships that are going on through alliances like AGRA. And that's the kind of thing that I feel we need to do more, even within the U.S., and I believe there are organizations that facilitate those type of exchanges. I know the MESA, which is the Multinational Exchange for Sustainable Agriculture, does a lot of exchanges between the U.S. and the Global South. IDEX is supporting a lot of regional learning exchanges in the Global South, in South Asia, South Africa, and in Mesoamerica. So there are examples of grassroots alternatives happening right now.
Great. Other questions?
Well, just to comment on the last comment, I work for an organization called FRB, Foods Resource Bank, and every summer we bring guests from overseas programs that we work with around the world to the United States, and it's always a treat to watch small farmers growing on under 5 acres, conversing with farmers in the United States, both big and small, and comparing production styles and methods. And there's learning that happens in both directions, and I've seen how that's influenced the way a lot of the farmers we work with here in the States have thought about their own farms and their own production. I once took a farmer from Minnesota, a young farmer who is a conventional crop farmer, to Central African Republic, and he was speaking with a woman who grows cassava and corn and small crops, but they also received U.S. food aid. And she asked him, well, what do you do with your corn and soybeans on your farm? How do you prepare them? And he said, oh, gosh, I've never, ever eaten them. We don't eat those crops. And she was shocked. And she fed him corn and soy porridge the next morning for breakfast. And he was sort of shocked at how untasty it was to him. And you know, that really has shaken his own mind. And he's really thinking now about what he's growing. And he sees his farm in a very different light. Those are some of the ways that we build bridges, is taking farmers from the U.S. to visit small farmers overseas as well, and helping to facilitate those kind of exchanges.
Yeah, that's great. Some of the rural justice tours that the agricultural missions has done in the U.S., where someone from overseas will come and we'll have a farmer from the U.S. as well, talking about the power structures and what kind of challenges they have before them, and to see that often they're the same ones, and often that comes down to corporations, the giant agri-food corporations that are so largely controlling both the markets and also the policies that get made that further perpetuate their control. And so just in that regard, wanted to mention that fast track around free trade agreements is coming up for a vote, and folks should definitely stay tuned to what's happening with that through PCUSA Hunger Program or the Citizens Trade Campaign to see when the best time for action is around that. That's coming up, so people should stay active on opposing fast track for free trade agreements. Other questions? We've got a few more minutes.
Andrew, I appreciated hearing both Margot and Katherine too, and I wanted to mention in terms of opportunities for farmers from the U.S. and Latin America to talk. There's the Community Agroecology Network has a short course, a 2-week course on agroecology that goes back and forth.
I can't hear you.
Oh, I'm sorry. Can you hear me now?
Barely.
Oh, dear. There's
a Community Agroecology Network that has academics and on-the-ground farmers from some U.S., well, from the U.S. and from some Latin American universities and countries, that has a course on agroecology that goes back and forth between a U.S. university and next year it's going to be in Nicaragua. This summer it was at University of Vermont. And I attended that this summer, and there were chances to hear how farmers in Mexico around Oaxaca and Veracruz were using agroecology. And also a really neat example of farmers rice farmers in the Philippines relearning the skills that they'd lost during the Green Revolution to rehybridize rice so that they could become self-sustaining in rice. My purpose wasn't saying this, but I interviewed somebody who's doing research on that, and on the website for What's for Dinner, you can hear that woman talking about what the farmers were doing in the Philippines. I wanted to ask, Katherine, what's going on in Mexico? Where has it gotten in terms of farmers trying to stop Monsanto? Has any place been reached?
So thank you for that question. There is a beginning of a movement of trying to stop Monsanto. It is very hard because government is very much working together with Monsanto to provide these fast-track permits for them, or not even permits, but like even allowing them to do field trials. Right now it's starting in the state of Sinaloa. Where I know there's been a lot of alternatives to this is in Chiapas, and it does have to do with the autonomous municipalities taking over the food sovereignty decision-making power of creating their own type of agroecology and providing the space for learning exchanges. So it will be interesting to see what will happen in the next years. I mean, it is quite a battle, but I think a lot of people are pretty committed that they don't want GMs born in Mexico. But I think there needs to be some process and time to get these movements strengthened in Mexico. And so it's hard to say where it's going to go, but I am optimistic that there is a lot of movement from the bottom up. But again, as I said before, there's just so much ties between the government and the Monsanto to get these GM field trials starting. Anyone else on the call has a much more update on this, please share.
Well, I pulled up the some news that was just sent to me from India. Thomas John is there as a partner with the Press Train Hunger Program, and folks, farmers from 20 states, you can see there, have gathered to protest the kind of fast-track introduction of GM crops into India. There's a strong movement against them, and they're at a crucial period right now where there's a new bill that would basically allow their entry into the country in a big way. So similar things happening in many places around the world. Other thoughts on this or other questions? We've got one more minute. Time for one more if there's a quick comment or question.
Andrew, I think this is almost, it's halfway for humorous relief, but
Andrew?
I was just going to mention that there was apparently an article in the magazine Elle, that is getting a fair amount of play about genetically engineered corn and its health effects on U.S. eaters, and it was encouraging to me that if there was debate coming from a magazine that was usually about women's health and women's fashion, it encouraged me a little bit.
Great. Was someone trying to get through a minute ago? Someone was saying my name.
Yes. Andrew, this is Jean Morris.
Okay, speak up if you can. It's hard to hear.
All right, I'm speaking into a telephone. I'll try to just talk louder.
Great.
Have you already covered the connection between trade reform or trade treaties and the ability to effectively suppress these local movements that we're saying need to be encouraged?
Good.
We now have. Yeah, that's a great point. And that's why opposing fast track for free trade agreements is a key part of this, to try to slow down the spread of these trade rules that make it easier and easier for these giant biotech companies to kind of make their way inroads into the markets of different countries. Thank you for that. Let me just quickly announce that next month's learning call will be with the Coalition of Immokalee Workers, and we hope to have Lucas Benitez or one of the other leaders on along with Noel D'Amico. So I welcome you to that and future calls the second Monday of each month at the same time. Thank you all for joining us today, and have a wonderful day.